What was it like actually getting to be on set of Modern Family and work with such a big cast and crew?
It was wonderful. One of the things that I love so much about that cast is that everybody there has such, the pedigree of a lot of those actors is pretty exceptional. And it turned out that Julie Bowen had been to college with my brother, and Ty Burrell I had seen in an off-Broadway play while I was doing a show on Broadway. So we got to talk about some things before we even got to shoot. And they were all so collaborative and so supportive and so fun. And Julie Bowen, every time I was back there, cracked me up beyond, I mean, just a wonderful, wonderful person. So they were really, really lovely. Yeah, everyone from top to bottom, really great. Steve Levitan, the executive producer, ran a very, very great show. I love my character in Overwatch so much. I love Symmetra, and I love the backstory that they've given her already so much that I'd really love to see more how she connects with the larger story, because she's one of the few characters right now that we don't necessarily see her interacting with the other characters, whether Talon or Overwatch. We don't know which side she's going to end up on, right? Because she definitely wants the world to be a better place, but you can tell she's having doubts about Vishkar. So I'm very, very interested to see more of that story develop and see how she, if she finds out what they're up to, as we have learned what they're up to. I'm definitely looking to see who she interacts with first among the rest of them. We had Zenyatta in the story, in the written story, but I think there's going to be a lot more. Like I said, I would like to see how she fits into the larger narrative a little bit, but because they've done such a great job of making her this wonderful combination of all the unique things that make her her, I think I'd just love to see more of her. That's the only thing. All of those characters, again, they did such a great job of... None of those characters are labeled by only one thing. Nobody is just the Brazilian one, or just the Mexican one, or just the Indian one. Nobody is just the gay one. Nobody is just the neurodiverse one, or just the... Everybody is unique and has these unique stories. And so I'd just like to see more of her interacting with more people. I think that's really lovely. And I would like to... I mean, they've done such a wonderful job of incorporating culture as we know it into this futuristic, fantastical world that is not the world that we currently live in. And so I'd love to see more of what they believe the future will look like when there's a world worth fighting for, as they like to see.
Since starting that role, do you feel there's been any changes in the industry?
Absolutely. I mean, without a doubt. And to say that it didn't affect things, I think would be... It changed the game, no pun intended, but unintended, in such a clear way, because it was so clear how many people were hungering for that just by the way that they connected to those characters. And I have a very firm... One of the reasons I love superhero stories of any kind, games, movies, comic books, whatever, is that when we see a hero that we can identify with for any reason, whether it's because we're a young girl and they're a young girl, or it's because they're neurodiverse and we're neurodiverse, for any reason... When we can identify with that, then we can see the hero in ourselves and take that out into the world. We'll take that confidence out into the world. And so I do feel like a lot of games and a lot of properties and franchises, in addition to games, are really embracing that because they're seeing the power of that. Mm-hmm. The power of how a unique and complicated narrative about a person can make such a difference in people's lives. And I do think that at their core, yes, obviously it's a commercial enterprise, the entertainment industry, but I think we're all storytellers for a reason. We chose that industry for a reason. And storytelling's been around for ages to be able to affect people.
Is there any particular props that you've used, or wardrobes that you've got to wear, that you've really enjoyed using or wearing?
Oh God, it's like picking your favorite child. There are so many good ones. I really enjoy... I did a show called Kevin Probably Saves the World with Jason Ritter, which was, first of all, just one of the loveliest, kindest sets I worked on, because it comes from the top down and Jason is just a sweetheart. We did a lot of volunteer work together at Young Storytellers in Los Angeles as well. But there was a scene where I, as a terminal cancer patient, he wanted to take me out to live a little. And we got to toilet paper, a house, put peanut butter on the car, and then I got to light the lawn on fire, ostensibly in the form of a male anatomical part, so you can see that in the grass. And I will say that that's probably the most fun thing I've ever had to do on set, on a TV set. On stage, I've been very, very lucky to be a part of two amazing Broadway productions. We did Bombay Dreams out there, which you guys I know had out here, and then Mary Zimmerman's Metamorphoses, which I got to be with from the inception all the way through Broadway, and that was set in a pool of water. So we did the whole show in a pool, and it was just magical. So both of those, you know, I don't think you can really say, like, when you've been lowered down from the rafters on a moon while you're singing, you're like, it's all downhill from here. You can't get better than that.
I'm wondering if there might be a particular superhero or supervillain you think you would like to play in either live action or in video games.
I mean, I feel like I'm uniquely suited to play the evil auntie. who kills you with her judgment. It's just a real life superhero villain, super villain. Gosh, what a great question. What would be a unique one that I'd be interested in playing? I mean, I really love all of the Marvel properties and the DC properties, but so I'm obviously like partial to those. I'm also a Trekkie. So I've been told many times that I would make an excellent Romulan. And I'm not sad about that. So I would happily take a little like little spot on Picard or a little spot on Discovery or something like that doing that. But I honestly like I feel like they're doing such a great job. I'm saying like a lot, obviously I'm from California. They're doing such a great job again in all of these franchises of creating these uniquely diverse people from all different backgrounds, from all different areas, that I feel like it just hasn't been written yet, what would fit me. She'd definitely have to be wearing these boots because I can run in these 4.5-inch heels, so that I know. I need my own shoes, that I can give you. But definitely someone who is action-oriented. I already got to play a Vulcan when Star Trek Beyond came out. I think I did a commercial for that. I mean, I'm really partial to prosthetics and, like, extreme cosplay. I've cosplayed as Symmetra and Dragon Symmetra and 3 hours of prosthetics. I really love that because when you have that time in the makeup chair, putting that on, all of a sudden there's almost no need for acting because you feel like you're embodying that character already. And you get to step into that character's shoes. So, I think I'm leaning towards Romulan... Vulcan, I think it would be one of the, I'd have to go Romulan, because they're just sinister, and I like that. We don't get to be that way in real life, so why not take the chance to be that way when you're playing?
What was it like, and how did you get the role to being Sopranos?
Oh, that was great. It was my second television job, and I was the last person in the audition, and... When they got to me, they hadn't called me in, and I was standing there waiting. They said, you're not on the list. And I'm like, well, I'm here, and I definitely have an appointment. So they let me in, ostensibly, even though I know I had an appointment. And I did my scene, and they asked me if I was a real doctor, and I said, no, I just grew up with a couple of them and decided to play them on TV. And that was it. It was the audition into the role. It was an exceptional set also to be a part of. Unfortunately, the whole time... Has anyone not seen The Sopranos here? Because if so, plug your ears. Because I'm about to spoil something. But the whole time that my scenes were with James Gandolfini when he was in the hospital with a tube down his throat. So we didn't really get to talk much because he had a tube down his throat. But Edie Falco was just... Watching her work was exceptional. Was just exceptional. For that to be my second job, I mean, I was very, 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 very lucky. And of course I was playing a doctor because what else would an Indian person be doing on The Sopranos back then? Like that makes more sense. When my brother found out, all he said was, just tell me you're not a Bada Bing girl. That's all I care about. You can be anything else on that show. Just don't be a Bada Bing girl.
Doing now lots of voiceover work, and I was wondering if you might have one bit of advice for anyone that's trying to get into that industry.
Well, there are a lot of incredible resources out there, first of all. Two resources that I'm going to plug because they are have been created by two of our fellow Overwatch actors. One is called iwanttobeavoiceactor.com. Dee Bradley Baker has an incredible site. Carolina might have said something about it before me because we love that site. It has all the information you need. And then our friend Jennifer Hale, who holds the Guinness record for most prolific voice actress. Like, she knows what she's talking about. She created a website called Skills Hub, skillshub.life, where you can go in and actually learn from some of the top voice actors in the industry one-on-one for like 10 minutes, 30 minutes, whatever. But honestly, it's just play with your instrument, which is your voice. Find out what silly things you can do. I honestly think the two main reasons that I do voiceover are theater, because I had the vocal training, but also because I make a lot of funny voices at home. I talk to the dog, I sing to the dog. My husband and I make silly voices at each other. We'll run around talking like this. Like, we'll just do crazy things and try things. The only rules that there are, I think, for any entertainment industry is be on time, be prepared, don't be a dick. Those are the three rules. Everything else is optional. Everything else is play and opinion and subjective. So just play with that instrument and have fun with it.